First of all, that we have to understand, you know, that why energy storage is required, particularly in a standalone system, because there are, you know, many remote locations are there where our grid or lines, you know, cannot go, you know, or it is not economically feasible, you know, to install the, you know, or to take the transmission lines and all those things. So there are many remote and, you know, like hilly areas in our country as well as in other countries. Okay, so the standalone system is the only option for them in such conditions. Okay, and therefore the standalone system, and they have plenty of, like, in such areas have plenty of, like, solar power, plenty of, like, wind power. So, you know, so therefore the renewable systems have the capability in such areas, you know, to make it out, and for any standalone system, you know, to maintain the frequency or to maintain the power balance between the source and the load, we must have the storage. Okay, because the renewable sources, you know, are not, you know, constant in nature. Okay, because they depend on the weather conditions, and they always vary. Okay, so that is called as intermittent nature of the renewable sources, and because of those intermittent nature of renewable sources, the storage becomes mandatory in standalone systems. Okay, so this is one aspect. Okay, and nowadays even though it is not a standalone system, you know, even though it is not a standalone system, in many, you know, urban areas or in many good localities also, now people are planning to have the energy storage. Okay, for example in Noida, the Tata Power has a huge energy storage in terms of the battery. Okay, so you might know it. Okay, so few years back they deployed a huge battery storage. Okay, huge battery storage in the Noida, somewhere in the Noida and Delhi that area. Okay, so that to reduce the fluctuations in the power supply. Okay, so now people are thinking about, you know, large storage even with the battery can be possible. So every storage, so we have many storages. We have, like, you know, battery is the very popular one. Okay, so battery, we have fuel cell, and then we have many other, like, you know, so we have pump storage, right? Okay, so we have an electrolyzer which can store the hydrogen. Okay, then one side we have ultra capacitor, one side we have SMEs, that is based on the inductance. Okay, so and every storage has their own merits and demerits. Okay, so from the operational point of view, also from the economics point of view. Okay, so right now the, you know, battery storages are more popular, and because right now they can be technologically, they are easily available. Okay, they are economical as well, right? Okay, so but other storages like fuel cell and those things, they are coming up. Okay, so mostly we work on some storage standalone system that I'm going to present here. Okay, so now I already mentioned that in many countries there are remote communities where connection with the power grid is too expensive or impractical. Okay, and diesel generators are often only the source of electricity, and under such condition the localists place small scale standalone systems, okay, are the good option. Okay, now in case of wind or solar, they are intermittent in nature, and therefore the storage is highly required. So we worked on certain wind as well as PV system on the renewable with the battery storage and also with the fuel cell storage, so that I'm going to present. Okay, now this is somehow this I we worked on, of course practically not we worked on, because electrolyzer and fuel cell were not available actually. Okay, but on the simulation and modeling, we worked on extensively on the performance analysis of those storages. So we took wind turbine generator, we took PV system, and then we took the battery system, and then we took the fuel cell, and also we took the electrolyzer. Okay, and then by combining all those sources, okay, we create one kind of a DC microgrid. Okay, we create one kind of a DC microgrid and then given to the load. Okay, so that sort of things that we have done in our work previously. Okay, so I'm going to present, you know, what is happening at the performance things are concerned. Okay, so you can see that, just look at here, that we have a generator, and then we have wind turbine generator, and then we have maximum power point tracking, PV system is directly connected, and then we have battery. So battery has its own bi-directional DC-DC converter, because battery has both way things, right? So battery can discharge or can take the charge, right? So therefore we need a bi-directional DC-DC converter in case of battery. And then we took the fuel cell as another backup power, as a storage. Okay, and then the fuel cell is connected to the DC bus. This is basically DC bus. Okay, all sources are connected to this DC line. Okay, so fuel cell is connected to DC bus, to the boost converter, and then the electrolyzer is connected to the DC bus with the buck converter. Okay, so electrolyzer, what it does, basically it converts the electrical energy into the hydrogen. Okay, and that hydrogen can be used by the fuel cell as a input. Okay, because the fuel cell requires input as a fuel cell, and the output of fuel cell is electrical power. Now in the other way, the electrolyzer has input is electrical power and output is the hydrogen. Okay, so that the hydrogen can be used by the fuel cell. Okay, so this is something like, you know, the complete sustainable model of the standalone system, with the all possible, looking at all possible sustainable energy storage solutions. Okay, because what happens, that see, battery storage is okay, we can deploy the battery storage, but the battery storage has one demerit, is that it has not the long lifetime. Okay, the battery has a replacement cost after 4 to 5 years. Okay, and therefore, to have a more sustainable kind of unit, we can have a fuel cell. Okay, but if surplus power is going to the fuel cell, okay, then or suppose surplus power is there from the renewable sources, then what will happen to that power? Okay, so instead of dumping that power can be used by the electrolyzer to convert the hydrogen. Okay, and then hydrogen can be stored, and the hydrogen can then be the input to the fuel cell when fuel cell requires to give the power. Okay, so that kind of the complete sustainable solution can be provided as far as the energy storage is concerned. Okay, now the merits of PMHG and those things, I think I will not go much in detail of that, because that is not the focus of today's lecture. Okay, so but I will not go, I will just go through it. Okay, I will not go in much detail of those things. Okay, so this, we took the ferromagnet magnet synchronous generator. Okay, instead of the doubly feed induction generator. So two technologies are widely used. One is doubly feed induction generators, and one is the ferromagnet magnet synchronous generators. Okay, what happens that in case of doubly feed induction generator, there is a gearbox is required to match the turbine and the rotor speed. Okay, so what happened that in doubly feed induction generator are nothing but our conventionally the induction generators. Okay, they are used as a super synchronous mode to deliver the, or use the induction, or use as a generators. Okay, so what happened that they we have a turbine. Okay, we have a turbine, and then we have a generator. Okay, so turbine is coupled with the generator, right? And turbine speed with the kind of wind velocity we have, okay, or kind of wind velocity we allow. Okay, the turbine speed is generally around, you know, 50 rpm or 45 ampere rpm, like that. Okay, however, in case of if you look at the induction generator, okay, if you look at the four pole machine, okay, the four pole machine has around 1500 rpm synchronous speed. Okay, Fine. And if you look at the, if you take the little above synchronous speed, and then it will be little above the synchronous speed. Okay. So we have to match the turbine speed to the synchronous speed. Okay. So turbine speed is 50 rpm, and let's say the synchronous speed is 1500 rpm. So to match the two speeds, okay, one has to use the gearbox. Okay. And gearbox always susceptible to the faults and regular maintenance. Okay. On the contrary, what happens in the permanent magnet synchronous generator? Okay. So PMEG is like a new technology. Okay. And in case of permanent magnet synchronous generator, okay, there is no field winding basically. There are permanent magnets to provide the field. Okay. And therefore, what happens that since the permanent magnets are used, okay, instead of the field winding, these permanent magnet synchronous generators, okay, they can be built with the multiple poles, okay, many number of poles, okay. So we know that NS is equal to 120 F by P, and if we increase the P, then NS will reduce, okay. So they can be built with the many number of poles, okay, and therefore the generator speed can be matched with the turbine speed, and therefore that gearbox you don't require, okay. That is what the beauty of the permanent magnet synchronous generator. But so far, permanent magnet synchronous generators are used only in the medium power application. Okay, and so far still the DFIG is widely used. Okay, and permanent magnet synchronous generators are used, but they are at the low power application. Okay, and to get the permanent magnets, you know, we need, you know, that kind of, you know, because permanent magnets you can get from the earth's crust, okay, and people are avoiding the permanent magnet synchronous generator another for one reason, because the permanent I don't know how it happened. Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I don't know what happened in between.
Okay, professor. Yeah, please share your screen, professor.
Yeah, power is there, everything is there, but anyway.
Anyway, sir, please share your screen. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So, is it visible now, screen?
Yes, professor. Yeah, visible.
Yeah. Actually, generally a small window comes here, but that window is not coming. So therefore, I'm not able to see whether I am, whether something has gone wrong or anyway. Okay. So, well, so I was in the maximum power point tracking. So maximum power point tracking is required both in PV characteristics as well as in wind characteristics. So you can see that in case of wind, just let me just make my mobile in the normal mode so that if something goes wrong, I should not miss your call. So we can see that at different wind velocities, at different operating speed, we can get the maximum power. Okay, so maximum power tracking is required both in wind as well as the PV sources. And that is what we can go for the, we have to do something, some arrangements using the converters so that we can go for the maximum power point tracking. We can operate the either PV array or wind turbine at the maximum power point tracking. Okay. Now come to the our main thing, that is standalone system. Okay. So since the standalone system is not connected to the grid, energy storage is mandatory. Okay. So battery can be a very good storage device. However, in case of long term no wind or a long term no PV power available, the battery alone cannot cater the load demand unless and until we have a huge storage of the battery. Okay, unless and until we have a huge storage of the battery. Okay, and battery have a replacement cost about 4 to 5 years. Okay, therefore fuel cell can be a good candidate to use as a backup supply in the standalone system. Okay. So in case of surplus, just a minute, just give me 1 minute, please. Yeah, sorry. So, am I audible?
Yeah, yes, sir. Yeah, you are audible.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. So, therefore, fuel cell can be a good candidate to use a backup energy storage. Okay. So now, as I told you that we should have a sustainable model of the storage. Either we have the huge battery backup, or if you have the less battery backup, then we should have a fuel cell. And along with the fuel cell, we could have a electrolyzer, because if there's a surplus power, then where the surplus power will go. Okay, to maintain the frequency and the voltage at the AC bus, we must have the power balance between the source and the local load. Okay, that is what is important. So therefore, in case of surplus power from the source and the battery is fully charged, then extra power can go to the electrolyzer. Okay. Electrolyzer generates the hydrogen, which can be used by fuel cell as its input. Okay. Now, the standalone system. So the control of frequency and magnitude of the supply voltage are the main requirements of the standalone system. Okay. In grid control system, what happened that a lot of things are governed by the main grid. Okay. Even if you have renewable energy sources, your frequency will be governed by the main grid. Okay. Then similarly, the voltage can be governed by the main grid. Okay, but in case of standalone system, okay, standalone system, as it, the inertia of the system is less. Okay, therefore the control of frequency is again the another challenge. Okay, so similarly, the other than the frequency and the voltage supply, maintaining frequency and voltage supply, we have voltage variations, flickers, harmonic generation, okay, load unbalance are the major power quality problems that occur in the standalone system. Okay, first is how to control the standalone system, then we'll go to the energy storage. Okay, now in standalone mode, the output AC voltage is controlled in terms of amplitude and frequency. So we know that we learned from in the basic polytonic book, okay, that how to, what is the inverter control. Okay, so inverter, we have a DC is an input to the inverter, and we have a AC output as an inverter. Okay, and therefore that, so DC voltage and AC voltage, so inverter DC voltage, inverter output has some relation. Okay, and that relation, whatever relation is there, I have made it here. Okay, so we can see that the line to line voltage of fundamental frequency, okay, is equal to, with this relation, K into VDC. Okay, so VDC is the DC link voltage of the inverter. Okay, and VLL is the AC voltage of the inverter. Okay, so, and where K is the modulation index of the PWM inverter, right? Okay, now here what we do, what, because we have to control the first part, is we have to control the frequency. Okay, so here, hence AC voltage can be maintained at rated value. Okay, AC means this voltage can be maintained at rated value by regulating the DC at its reference value. Okay, and keeping the K, that is modulation index, okay, within a reasonably practically limit. Okay, so that is what is important. Okay, here we have to keep the, just a minute, just give me 1 minute. I'm really sorry, I got some phone call. Just give me 1 minute.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you, but your voice is not audible and some other voice is coming out, sir.
Yeah, sorry. Is it audible now?
Now it is audible, sir. Till
yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is audible. Yeah. Now.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So by maintaining the DC voltage at its reference value, and by keeping the modulation index in the practical reasonable limit, we can control the, we can maintain the AC voltage of inverter. Okay. So I am again going back. I am talking about this AC voltage, because if you look at here, so I am talking about this inverter. I am talking about this DC voltage. I am talking about this AC voltage. Okay. So AC, this is the PCC bus or AC bus. Okay, where our all electrical loads are connected. Okay. So fine. And then now this is about the voltage. Okay. Now second thing about the frequency. Okay, how to control the frequency. So what happened that, so as far as the frequency of output AC voltage is concerned, it can be maintained at a specified value by choosing the frequency of sinusoidal reference signal while generating the PWM pulses. So what happens that we generate the pulses to the inverter. Okay, and while generating pulses to the inverter, what we do, we compare the reference signal, reference sinusoidal signal, with the carrier waveform. Okay, So Curry waveform may have switch. Curry waveform is nothing but of the switching frequency. Okay, it may be like 1 kilohertz, 2 kilohertz, or something. Okay, and then that Curry waveform is compared with the sinusoidal waveform. Okay, so sinusoidal waveform has the fundamental frequency. Okay, so suppose in our country we have to maintain the frequency at 50 hertz. Okay, so that sinusoidal waveform should have a frequency of 50 hertz. Okay, and then so while generating the pulses to the inverter, to the PWM inverter, okay, so if you choose the reference waveform at 50 hertz, the frequency of output voltage will be the 50 hertz. Okay, so that's how we have to maintain the frequency at the output of the inverter, okay, in case of standalone system. Okay, now so control of DC link voltage. So what is important? So important is that the control of DC link voltage. So again, I'm going back here. Okay, so here, so this DC link voltage control is very important because all sources are connected to this DC link. Okay, and this, so we need to control this DC link voltage. And that way indirectly we have to control those storages. Okay, now so due to variations in the wind or in the PV power, DC link voltage varies because of power mismatch between source and the load. So what happens that, so you just imagine a source. Okay, imagine a source. Okay, and then you have which is DC source. Okay, it may be a PV. Okay, and you have an inverter, and then we have a AC load. Okay, so anything power imbalance will be there. Suppose source power will be more. Okay, source power will be more than the load power. Okay, then the DC link voltage will increase. Okay, and the reverse thing will happen. Suppose the load power will be more than the source, then DC link voltage will go down. Okay, so due to variations in the wind power or PV power, the DC link voltage varies because of the power mismatch between the source and the load. Okay, and hence the voltage can be maintained constant by regulating DC link voltage constant at its reference value and keeping the modulation index of PWM inverter within a reasonable practical limit. Okay, so our main idea is to maintain the DC link voltage constant. Okay, now come to the dynamic response of the storages. Okay, now what happened that the fuel cell, if you look at the fuel cell, there are some mechanical equipments are inside the fuel cell. Okay, and therefore the fuel cell dynamics is slow, right? Okay, and therefore what happens that since fuel cell dynamics is slow, so battery is required to supply the power during the transient condition. Okay, and therefore a small size of battery can be used. Okay, so the battery, fuel cell and the electrolyzer are used to maintain the power balance of the system. So those storages are used to maintain the power balance of the system. So suppose PV power is varied or wind power is varied. Okay, suppose it is more than the load, right? Then we should have the storage system to take that power, surplus power. Okay, or if load power is more than the source power, then we should have energy storage to supply that deficit in the source power. Okay, and therefore those three storages are combined to maintain the power balance of the system. Okay, now the control coordination is very important among three storages. Okay, so when the battery is fully charged, the power is supplied by the fuel cell, so that kind of control strategy must be required among three storages. Okay, so the deficit energy in case of low wind speed or in case of low PV power is provided by the battery, and surplus energy in case of high wind speed or more PV power is taken by the battery within the specified limit. Okay, in case of higher wind speed or higher PV power, if the battery is fully charged, the surplus power is dumped into the dump load, and here dump load is nothing but my electrolyzer. Okay, fine. So that kind of power management system is required among the storages. So looking at that looking at that power management things, okay, the control scheme for those controllers, I'm again going back to the main system, okay. So the control scheme for power management, so power management is done with the help of those converter controls, okay, DC-DC converter control, buck converter control, and the boost converter control, okay. So power management is done with the help of those three controllers. Now we can go to the battery control, okay. So in case of, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Yes, sir. So in between, yes, I'm asking
sir,
because.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine.
Yes, sir. Fine. Sir, again, repeat for power management battery controller.
Yeah. So we're at the now we'll see the battery control. So what happens that, so here I took the DC link voltage, okay, as a control parameter, okay, and then this DC link voltage is maintained at the reference DC link voltage, okay. So this is the DC link voltage measured from the DC link, okay, and then the reference DC link voltage, it is going to the PI controller, and then which is output of PI controller, nothing but my reference battery current, okay, because as I told you that, you know, if source power is more than the load, then DC link voltage will increase, okay. So that increase and decrease in DC link voltage gives me the indirectly how much should be the my battery charging or discharging current, okay, and therefore, and then so that becomes my reference battery current, and then it is compared with the actual battery current, and then after taking to the hysteresis, I can draw the pulses to the gate pulses to the battery to the DC-DC bidirectional converter connected to the battery, okay. Then another one is important thing is requirement is that we have to charge and discharge the battery within some limit of state of charge, okay. The state of charge nothing but the charge remained in the battery, okay, that calculation called as the state of charge, okay. So the if you look at the literature, it is given in the literature that if you limit the battery state of charge within those certain limit between 0.2 to 0.8 or 0.1 to 0.9, okay, then the battery life increases, okay, and therefore generally all people, you know, they maintain the state of charge within that limit, means they don't allow to discharge the battery fully, or they don't allow to charge the battery fully, okay. So discharge the battery up to 0.2 or 0.1 state of charge of limit, okay, or charge the battery up to 0.8 or 0.9 state of charge of limit, okay. So that controller logic, that control logic we added in this control, okay. Now come to the dump load control. So the dump load control means the controller goes to the electrolyzer, okay. So the first requirement of the battery is fulfilled, and then excess power is fed to the dump load. This is done by monitoring the state of charge of battery continuously, and when state of charge reaches the limit, okay, when state of charge reaches the limit, okay, then excess power is dumped to the dump load, and here dump load is the electrolyzer, okay. So converter associated with the electrolyzer, okay, is used to control this power flow, okay. So when the state of charge is more than 80%, then only the additional power is going to the dump load or the electrolyzer. Now come to the fuel cell control. So now when we are trying to make the control logic for fuel cell, firstly we tried to do it with the DC link voltage control, but then we found that there was a conflict between the battery control and the fuel cell control, because for the battery as well as fuel cell, when they discharge or when they give the power, they're both the purpose is same, okay. So there was a conflict was happening between the battery and fuel cell. So therefore the fuel cell controller, we took it from the current parameters, okay, instead of the voltage parameters, okay. So we can see that this is ID and this IG, So we can see here in the diagram possibly what is ID and IGI given. So you can just see that maybe ID is nothing but distilling current. ID is nothing but, yeah, sorry. So yeah, somehow somewhere this is, yeah, okay. So somehow this is the IG and this is the ID, okay, and in between we have the battery current, okay. So the connection point of the battery, so before that current and after that current, we took it as a parameter for the to control the fuel cell, okay. So fuel cell, so controls associated with the battery and fuel cell are developed in such a fashion that when there's a sudden load change, yeah. So let me tell you one more aspect is here. What happens that the fuel cell has slow dynamics, okay, and the battery has the fast transient response, or battery has the fast dynamics, okay. Means for fuel cell it takes time to supply the power to the steady state or full load power, whatever requirement, okay. But battery can supply the power immediately, okay. And therefore we have to be very, very careful while designing the controllers, okay. And those controllers are taken from the, for fuel cell, this is taken like a difference between ID and IG, okay, given to the PI controller, which is nothing but the output of PI controller is nothing but the reference fuel cell current, okay. It is compared with the actual fuel cell current, and then according to the pendulum pulses to the controller connected to the fuel cell is given, okay. And this controller will act only when the state of the charge of the battery is less than the 0.2, okay. So with those controllers, now this is the power measurement, energy management algorithm, okay. So we can just have the overall energy management algorithm. If distilling voltage is more than the reference distilling voltage, then check the SOC of the of the battery, okay. If SOC is greater, okay, then give surplus power to equalizer. If no, charge the battery from the wind or PV, okay, because this side is VDC is more, means this side is more having the surplus power, okay, and VDC is less means we have a deficit power, okay. So again, check the state of the limit. If it is greater than 0.2, then discharge the battery into the load, okay. If no, then fuel cell will maintain the load demand, so that way we have to manage it. Now now another problem that I occurred, just give me one minute, just. So another problem that we occurred as a peculiar Paul Corti problem is that in the distribution system the loads are always unbalanced, okay, and therefore the voltage imbalance is expected to occur. This generally happen because, you know, what happens that because after your PWM means your sources, your storage, and then we have PWM inverter. And after that, we have then small filters to remove the high frequency harmonics from the output AC voltage, okay. And then we have a small, we may have a small distribution feeder or a small transmission line, and then we may have a load, okay. So because of and the load is always unbalanced, distribution load is always unbalanced, and because of the impedance between the PWM inverter and the load, okay, the unbalanced current flows and the impedance becomes the unbalance, and therefore the PCC voltage, okay, will also have a unbalance. Okay, so means the voltage at the load buses will also have the unbalance because of the unbalance impedances. Okay, and that load unbalance has the two bad effects on this side. Okay, so one is that oscillations in the generator torque. Okay, what happens that because of that unbalance, there's analysis, you can look at the analysis. If there's an unbalance on the AC side, then on DC side there will be a 2 omega oscillations. Okay, on DC side there will be a 2 omega oscillations, or you can just do this exercise. Okay, you take VA, VB, VC. Okay, VA is equal to Vm sin omega t, VB is equal to Vm sin omega t minus 120 degree. Okay, so similarly VA, VB, VC, and you take the IA, IB, IC. Okay, and take the currents unbalance. Okay, and if you multiply those VA, IA plus VB, IB plus VC, IC, so you will find that you will get one the average power. Okay, that is the DC power, and we'll get another term as the 2 omega term. Okay, so that 2 omega oscillation terms, okay, comes on the DC side. Okay, and therefore there will be a, or there can be a, the electrical torque pulsation in the generator torque. Okay, and there will be a, so there will be a mismatch between the electrical torque and the mechanical torque, and therefore the, you know, life of the generator shaft will reduce. Okay, so unbalanced PC voltages and the oscillation generator torque, okay, are the two detrimental effects of the unbalanced load. Okay, and that's, and therefore those are controlled again using the DC-DC converter connected to the battery. Okay, so earlier only this was the control. So to control that, we have added this another small controller to the reference battery current. Okay, so idea is that those 2 omega oscillations, okay, they will flow through the battery DC-DC converter, and it will not flow through the generator side. Okay, so that was the idea. Okay, similarly, to control the PCC voltage, we have taken the PI controller. Okay, so here basically the idea is that we have taken the individual voltages of the individual phases. Okay, so here the modulation indexes will be little different of the individual phases. Okay, and which can tackle the unbalance in the PCC voltages. Okay, so by building the appropriate control schemes, we have tackled those problems. Okay, now, well, unit sizing can be done using many softwares are available there. Okay, we also done the unit sizing. Unit sizing means what could be the size for particular load and particular source availability, what could be size of the what will be size of your PV power or wind power or storage power. That we have done using the HOMAR software, okay, which is provided by the NREL department, US Department of Energy. Okay, we have used that and we did that. Now come to the results. Okay, we can see that by using the control management scheme, we can control the, so there are the current load variations and there are the wind speed variations. Okay, instead of load variations and the wind speed variations, the DC link voltage is maintained constant, and therefore the AC link volt maintained constant. Okay, now you can see that, so for those sources change and the variation in the source and the variation in the current, okay, or load, okay, the power variations are given here. Okay, so you can see that the wind power and then battery power, and then there's a load demand is changing here. Okay, so there's a power balance is happening. Okay, now look at very interesting point, what I wanted to show it here basically. Okay, So when the load demand is suddenly increased, see here at this point, the load demand is suddenly increased. Okay. At this point, at t equal to 1 second, the load demand is suddenly increased. Okay. And when the load demand is suddenly increased, the battery responses instantaneously. Okay. Look at here, the battery responses instantaneously. Okay. And since fuel cell dynamics is slow, as I told you that fuel cell dynamics is slow. Okay. Even though, so both have started their operation, but fuel cell will start later. Okay. After a certain point. And then, so at the moment, at the transient moment of the load demand, increase in load demand, the battery will respond. Okay. And then as when the fuel cell will start feeding the power, the battery will start reducing its power. Okay. So in steady state, the fuel cell gives the power, and in steady state, the battery power becomes zero. Okay. So the response of battery is very fast and can meet the rapidly increasing load demand. Okay. Provided maximum discharge limit should be within the 3 times its rating. I'll come to this point. Okay. So this way, this could enable, because of the proper control scheme made between the fuel cell and the battery. Okay. So these are some real time results. So we have RTDS in our lab. So these are some real time results. Okay. So let me tell you the difference between simulation results and the real time results. In case of simulation results, suppose we give the 5 minute time, may not be 5 minute time of our watch. Okay. But in case of real time results, in case of RTDS, there is a parallel processing is happening and therefore it is very fast, and the 5 minutes given in the real time is nothing but equivalent to the 5 minutes of our watch. Okay. So that's what is called as the real time. Okay. And so we have found that the real time, the response time of those things, in case of real time and the simulation were more or less same. Okay. So, and these are the results of unbalanced thing. You can see that the load currents are unbalanced, and therefore you can see that the oscillations in the DC link voltage. So this is the little less black means little less blacks are the oscillations without DC-DC converter control, okay, for unbalance, and those black is nothing but the with DC-DC controller, okay, for unbalance. So you can see that the DC link voltage, so after adding the controller here, the DC link voltage, variation DC link voltage are reduced, and if you don't use that controller, then there will be a 2 mega oscillation in the DC link voltage. These are the torque repulsions. These are the electrical torque repulsions. Okay. This is the without DC link controller, means without the unbalanced controller, and this is the with the controller. Okay. So you can see that the torque repulsion decreases. Similarly, the voltage unbalance factor. Okay. Voltage unbalance factor, let me tell you the voltage unbalance factor, it's nothing but ratio of negative sequence voltage to the positive sequence of fundamental components. So that is called as voltage unbalance factor. Okay. So voltage unbalance factor reduces to 0.4% from the 2.6%. Okay. So that was what we have done here. Okay. Now, so that was the first part that I have done. Okay. So the coordinate control is proposed to regulate the voltage of a standalone hybrid system. Okay. It is observed that the controller can maintain the load voltage quite well in spite of variation in wind speed, PV power, and the load. Okay. Sorry, I'm just getting a call. Hello. Yeah, I will talk to you after some time, madam. I'm in talk. Okay. So algorithm is developed to achieve power energy management among wind, PV battery, and electrolyzer. Okay. The proposed energy management algorithm is simple and requires measurement of only DC link voltage or current and does not require measurement of powers. Okay. The effect of unbalanced load and generator is analyzed, and DC-DC converter control is proposed to reduce its effect on the electrical torque of generator. Is wrongly written. Okay. The prevalent inverter control is incorporated to balance the line voltage at PCC under the condition of unbalanced load. Okay. So now this is what we have done in the first phase. Now let me come to the some another portions. Okay. Now what we have done, that we have also seen the, you know, suppose there are faults on the distribution line, then what could be the effect and how we can control it. Okay. So now we have taken a simple generator, okay, wind generator and a battery. Here we have not taken the fuel cell and all those things, okay, because analysis would be more complicated. So we have taken the battery storage here only, okay, and then we have taken the small feeder, okay, like 0.5 kilometer feeder, 1.5 kilometer feeder or 2 kilometer feeder, as all three phase feeders, okay, and then the three phase loads are there, okay. So all those are three phase loads. You can see that all those are three phase loads. Okay. Hello. Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah. Please proceed, sir. Yeah.
Ah. Okay. Sorry. I thought I need to stop or something. Okay.
No. Okay. No problem, sir. You please carry on. Yeah.
Okay. So we took this small feeder. Okay. Having three phase, or you can say that we took the small line, distribution line. Okay. Having each line having three phase circuits, okay, and then we have done some fault analysis, okay. So if fault happens in the feeder, what will happen, okay? So now effect of faults, okay. So subjected to fault after opening of circuit breaker, huge unbalance will be at PCC, okay. So let's say there is a single line to ground fault, okay, and the circuit breaker opens, okay. So there will be a, because of that, huge unbalance occurs at PCC, okay, and that unbalance due to particular load will also have hamper to the other loads connected to the same PCC. So you can see that the severity of the or sensitivity of the load happening, okay. Suppose something wrongly bad happens to this feeder, okay, this feeder, the other feeders or other loads are also connected to the same bus, okay. And therefore, the other loads may hamper. Okay, so the unbalance voltage imbalance factor may be more than limit. Okay, and may affect to the other loads. Okay, so generally the motors are employed with a negative sequence relay, and they may trip if the unbalance factor is more. Okay, so these are some kind of problem. Okay, which happens. Okay, and so during fault, very high current flows. Okay. Through the fault line and corresponding inverter leg, hence inverter will stop operating. So what happens that whenever there is a fault, okay, whenever there is a fault, all sources try to fit that fault, right? So what happens that when there is a fault, the huge fault current flows because of the short circuit, right? And all sources tries to fit the fault. Okay. Now what happened that, let me tell you, in many countries, okay, the even though in research we talk about many advanced control schemes and all those things, okay. But generally industries do not generally industries always have lagging to those new technology control, okay, because in power industries the technology comes slowly, okay, as far as industries are concerned, okay. So in many countries what they have, they do not have such kind of things, okay. So what happens that, and moreover what happens that these Paltonic converters, they built with their own, you know, their own control circuits like snubber circuits, and in the control also they have their own current control limits, okay. And therefore, you know, many times it happens that suppose your relay setting is of 5 ampere, okay. So relay setting is of 5 ampere, suppose relay setting is of 10 ampere. Okay, I'm talking about the secondary side of relay. Okay, let me talk about primary side of that relay. Okay, suppose your relay setting is suppose of 50 ampere. Okay, a normal current, let's say within 50 ampere. Okay, and suppose even though fault current becomes your more than 50 ampere. Okay, and your converter control, okay, will not allow to reach that much current. So your relay will not trip, okay. So therefore, the old inverters which are employed already, they cannot, you know, in that case, the relay cannot, you know, the relay cannot trip or give the trip signal. Relay cannot send the fault, okay? So therefore, what is happening that right now in many abroad countries also, in many developed countries also, the inverters, they are employed, okay? They are, means, they are underutilized 3 times, okay? For example, somewhere we have a 50 ampere normal current rating. So the employed inverters are 150 ampere. Okay, because those new control schemes have not come up so far in the industries. Okay, obviously they will come in the future, near future. Okay, and therefore this point is also important from that point of view. Okay, now here the one aspect of battery control converter is the same, okay, here, but here one thing we found that whatever we observed here that what happened that during fault, that is period between occurrence of faults and opening of circuit breaker, okay, the current is very high, okay, and particularly for LG and double LG faults, 3-phase currents are highly unbalanced, okay, and as I told you that therefore we have the 2 omega oscillations with high amplitude present in the DC link voltage. So now what is happening that, so we have a 2 omega oscillations, okay, print DC link voltage. And then the battery has to damp that oscillations, right? Okay. And therefore, what we have found that this battery can discharge 3 times its rated capacity. Okay. Battery can discharge 3 times its rated capacity during transients. Okay. However, it cannot charge in that fast manner. Okay. So then we have seen some literature that the battery was unable to damp out the oscillations. Okay. And then we thought of what could be the reason for that, okay, and then we found some literature that the battery can discharge 3 times its capacity, okay, how it cannot charge in that fast manner, okay, and therefore to damp out the 2 omega oscillations, okay, we have to use the resistive dump load control, okay, and therefore you can see that we have used the resistive dump load control, okay, to damp out those 2 omega oscillations for the happening in the battery, okay, and therefore this also controller is the same whatever we have seen earlier, okay, and we had certain other problems to find out the FPPT. I'm not going into that, and I'm mostly interested in showing you this one, okay. So you can see that this is the DC link voltage, okay, this is the DC link voltage, and you can see that this gray one, okay, means less black one, gray one is the without dump load control, okay, gray one is the without dump load control, okay, and this black one is with the dump load control, okay, so gray one was without dump load control and the black one was with the dump load control. So you can see that when we use the dump load controller, then those oscillations are reducing, okay, but earlier with the battery control, mere battery control, the oscillations were not reducing, okay, because the battery couldn't follow that variations in the variations due to the unbalance, okay, due to the 2 omega oscillations, okay, and therefore we have used the resistive dump load control, and this is the control for the resistive dump load control, okay. Here we took that reference DC link voltage, we took it as the 5% more in the DC link voltage. I mean, generally what happens that we allow 5% more in DC link voltage, okay, basically what happens that why can't we allow the more variation in DC link voltage, basically for the safety of the DC link, okay, because the capacitors are connected to DC link, the other fault and device are connected to DC link. Okay, therefore, generally the variations in DC link voltage allowed is generally 5 to 10%. Okay, so not more than 10%, and therefore here we took as a 5% limit. And when the DC link voltage is more than 5%, crosses the 5% limit, then our dump resistive dump load controller will be in use. Okay, so that's what we have used here. Okay, now the another one more small topic I will cover, and then we can go for the questions and answering. Okay, so in one system we have connected, because see what happens that in many places we use the diesel generator. So we thought of, let us not ruled out completely diesel generator, because PV power has its own limit, okay, battery has its own limit. So let us not rule out completely the diesel generator, but combine the renewable sources with the diesel generator and the battery, okay, and use of diesel generator at a minimal use, okay, at the minimal level. So that kind of thing we have assumed, and then there also we have connected PV and then battery and then diesel generator, and then we developed the control schemes. Okay, we developed the control schemes. Okay, so here what happened that sometimes we may need the requirement of deloading of PV. Okay, let me come to that that point. Okay, so now, because as we use any different equipment, so we have to see its operational feasibility. Okay, so here what happened that if you look at the diesel generator, okay, so what is the limitation of diesel generator apart from carbon footprint and all those things? Okay, as the operational constraint of the diesel generator, okay, what happens that the diesel generator, you know, the operating the diesel generator below minimum threshold is not advisable. Okay, see, what we can vary the diesel generator power depend on your PV power and your battery power, right? What is the idea is that the diesel generator we can operate at the lower limit, okay, depend on the available of PV power and the battery storage. Okay, and by operating the diesel generator at lower limit, we are basically reducing the basically fuel consumption, right? Okay, but it has its own operational constraint or limit. Okay, the operating the diesel generator below minimum threshold is not advisable as far as its plant performance is concerned. It is highly inefficient as far as its performance concerned if you operate it below certain minimum threshold. Okay, fine. And under such condition, so you have to keep it operating, you have to keep the diesel generator operating at a particular minimum threshold level. Okay, and under such condition, okay, if the surplus power is there, surplus P power is there, and suppose battery is fully charged, okay, then we have to reduce the power from the battery. Okay, we have to reduce the power from the PV. Okay, and that is called as deloading of PV. Okay, that is called as deloading of PV. So let me just go to your this thing. Okay, if you look at, this is the PV power characteristics. Okay, so my main aim was to operate here. Okay, but because of the diesel generator constraint, now I have to operate at the deloaded power. Okay, so even though I am losing the PV power, okay, but from the operational point of view, to maintain the source power and the load, to maintain the power balance, I have to do it. Okay, and therefore we have done it some other addition in the control circuit. Okay, control circuit, and then in this condition my deloaded power will be my DC link voltage. Okay, so in this condition my deloaded the PV power, okay, corresponds to the DC link deloaded power will be my the reference DC link voltage. Okay, and that's what we did it. Okay, so with those control schemes, and this is the inverter control. Okay, and here we have used DQ frame inverter control. Okay, here, and here we need the phase lock loop. As I told you that when some other generator connect to the AC bus, okay, what happened that here basically the generator, so the diesel generator has certain frequency, say 50 hertz, right? And our inverter has to run synchronously with the generator frequency. Means the frequency of this generator should be synchronized with the frequency of the output frequency of the PWM inverter, and therefore we need the phase lock loop for that purpose. Okay, so phase lock loop is connected here, okay, so that the frequency of the generator should be in synchronism with the frequency of the PWM output voltage, okay, or PWM inverter output voltage, okay. And so these are the results. You can see that the torque repulsions, you can see that even though the currents are unbalanced, the load currents are unbalanced, okay, even though the load currents are unbalanced, the diesel generator currents are balanced, okay. So this could happen because of our control scheme, okay. And you can see that the balance currents at DG eliminate the 2 omega oscillations from the electrical torque of generator, okay. I am talking about this diesel generator from perspective, okay. So in spite of unbalanced load currents, inverter makes the DC currents balance, okay, and therefore the 2 mega oscillations are reduced in the electrical torque of diesel generator, okay. Now this is the deloaded power, okay. You can see that the power is deloaded here, okay, and then to have the power balance, okay, we have a load power equal to PV power, DG power, and the battery power, okay. So we have some hardware in loop results here that we have also verified with the RTDS and using microcontrol results, whatever simulation results are there, okay. And well, so this is end of my lecture, and these are, because this I have done in 2011 to 14, this work along with my one PhD student. So this is my old work, okay, and this is my old work, and now the forum is open for the discussion.